name's Cushman, and thank you so much. I have a question because you outlined brilliantly the kind of map of so many players from a very local to global way, the way you showed how all the ecological, economical, all these aspects are connected, and I've never really heard them all these different issues put together with all the players. And there's one aspect of the whole kind of story and map and web that you've woven so beautifully and so clearly that I'm a little unclear about. And it seems to me that at every level, whether it's the state of India not acknowledging the Adivasis or Washington, D.C. not acknowledging India, like it's the same thing is happening. Each group is doing it, whether it's the city to the slum dwellers, it keeps repeating. And I'm wondering that even though each group experiences that at some level, what is the underlying attitude or perspective that is not being broken through, that it keeps repeating on every level? What is this attitude that allows for this conflict of interest and corruption at every level, in each direction, whether we're looking at it horizontally or vertically? Because I'm just astounded that it keeps repeating when you offer such great alternatives at every level and through all systems, and yet it's not seen. So there's some sort of fundamental ignorance that is happening that I feel that is all important for each of us as an individual to recognize so that it can be a part of this sort of revolutionary change that you're proposing.
In one word, consumerism. Again, you know where it comes from. But in another sense, the relationship between the human being and human being is lost, is being lost. It still is there in large majority of population, but is lost in certain sections of the humanity itself. So they are also human beings, and they are capable of changing. Who knew that Asima Nand in the jail would be thoroughly changed when a Muslim person serves him inside the jail and bring out the fact that the Hindu fundamentalists caused the blasts and not the Muslims, which we knew from our investigation within Malegaon of Maharashtra. So the change is possible. The heartfelt change is possible. Only if you come to see yourself, what is the kind of inhuman subsistence that your sisters or brethren are, living with, you can change absolutely. I think even that is missing. The present education system and the kind of inculcation of wrong kind of values, is really killing that value of humanitarian attitude and relationships. And similarly, the relationship between human being and nature is also changed. Nature is no doubt enjoyable when you pay 2,000 to 2 lakh rupees for a night in the distant tourism spots and so on. But otherwise, it is a commodity to be used in everything. The wood comes from the forest at the cost of indigenous people, so on. Okay, you use the resources. You have a right yourself, but they also have right, and they also have stakes. So at least that multi-stakeholder exercises, as the World Bank calls it, we went through it beautifully during the World Commission on Dams. I'll give you a story if you want it. How we proved ourselves to be social engineers, as the wives of one of the engineers said to her husband, that look, they are proving to be social engineers, so you must sign this unanimous report. So similarly, I think, it is possible at least to take all the participants together. At least that should be the democratic principle. And when you follow it in your conferences, in your offices, in your banks, in your corporate offices, why can't you do that in the communities and with the communities? That is lacking and missing. So in the name of democracy, what Arundhati Roy said, the banana republic, it's true. You know, there is no real democracy. And India has this long tradition of, if not similar to the Greek Ganarajas, these small communities. Of course, there is inequity within community, which one cannot forget. I am not denying that. To leave aside casteism as a problem or the Dalits issues as issues within the Gram Sabha will, you know, make us not appear but function as naive citizens. So I'm telling the Aam Aadmi Party people also that your Swaraj must take due cognizance of the inequities within. Otherwise, Baba Sahib would never forget and forgive us. And if today Gandhi, Ambedkar, Marx were present, they would have been together to give us the same vision which the common people of India are presenting. So I think this attitudinal change is necessary, and market is changing it the other way, towards consumerism, towards inorganic agriculture, which is again market-based agriculture, so on and so forth. So in each sector also, the market is playing a role. We must not have no markets. There are ways of not just old barter system, but also ways of giving and taking back. But there should be at least fairness, as it is said in this part of the world. I don't think more than that, everything goes to spiritual. I'm not traversing through that path. Because, you know, I mean, humaneness is also a result of spirituality. You don't need to really sit in meditation all the time, but you meditate over your visions and I think you get the answers. Thank you so much for helping me filling the gaps.
Thank you very much for all your work. It's been extremely admirable. With that very sincere thanks, I also want to raise the question about the idea of India. At least for me, one of the central features of the idea of India is secularism. And again, for me, the one person, even more than Gandhi, who personified that idea of India was Nehru. And yet, in your introduction and in the first part of your talk, all of you danced around talking about Gandhi, Ambedkar, Sardar Patel without any mention of the idea of Nehru and of secularism and of Nehru. You did come to him later in your talk. So my question is, asking where does the IFA stand on that issue, because in that introduction again, in talking about the idea of India, that was conspicuously missing in both cases. So where do you stand on secularism? And then in Aam Aadmi Party, there are, and I have no way of knowing, reports of Kejriwal having talked to BJP to form some kind of an agreement before they won the Delhi elections. So again, it would help us to know what your reading is of where the Aam Aadmi Party stands on secularism. Thank you.
You see, we belong to a secular force in India, but that word is many times considered as a derogatory one. And secularism for us means, I can better explain it in Hindi, dharma nirapekshata in politics, and sarva dharma samabhav in social life. That is the tradition I belong to, and that is the category I belong to, and that is a must for anyone who follows Indian constitution. And I do not deny the contribution of Nehru. The unity in diversity, which I mentioned to without his name, was referring to his idea, and that also was taken ahead by him up to national integrity. But I don't think Gandhi contributed any way less to the idea of secularism, nor did Baba Saheb, nor anyone else. And they were all secular people, and that's why they brought in secular India with its secular constitution. And yet the communal forces in India are at their worst even today. And that is one reason why we feel that the entering into politics is also a must for many, many, many secular people. We are afraid that the non-communal face that is presented, whether by Narendra Modi or others, is not the true face even today. Because not just Gujarat riots, but even the post-riot scenario tell us that it is being done for more for the vote bank than with the real change of heart. And we feel therefore that we can never tolerate anything that is communal. Although I used communalism as the word in the other context deliberately so. We are also afraid of the Hindu-Muslim, breaking of the relationships, which is deliberately done. I still feel that the terrorism and whatever comes to anyone's help to push fundamentalism ahead needs to be exposed. And yet terrorism in fundamentalists in each religion also need to be pointed out and said no to. And every religion has fundamentalism, which leads to communalism, and that we are opposed. So the building relationships, bringing in true integrity is not really limited to the political interventions. It cannot be. It has to be at the much wider and in-depth social levels as well. And so we are also active at that front. The latest riots in Muzaffarnagar, oh, I forgot. I brought some books. My colleagues, I could not go there at the right point of time. I was engaged in court cases, which I played. But my colleagues worked there for a few months immediately after the riots, and their experiences are noted down in the book that we have published as National Alliance of People's Movements. So in every riot, we feel that the women are targeted. Their dignity becomes a false issue that the patriarchal society really hypes upon, and small little and fake incidents become the immediate charger or charging points for the riots to erupt. But otherwise, the majority of Indian community is for peace, for equality and dignity of every religion. They are for, helping each other and relating with each other. And that needs to be stressed. So instead of just, moving everything around the communalism and fundamentalism, this needs to be stressed. But when it comes with its black face, we must counter it also. In politics, all parties say they are secular, with one paragraph here and there which makes a difference, and we identify those in some parties. But the secular parties also use caste and religion as a basis to protect and gain their vote banks. That's why this is neo communalism or neo casteism that is coming up through politicization of caste and religion, as I said it. And hence that also needs to be challenged. Because on one hand, we need and we should carry out the reservation, the positive discrimination agenda, as we believe in our future vision of India also. But how far? Only that far, till when we cannot achieve equity through the right kind of universal policies. and through right kind of supportive measures. So the scheduled castes will remain to be scheduled till they are still highest percentage among landless. They have highest percentage amongst BPL holders, below poverty line holders. They have highest percentage amongst unemployed. They have highest percentage amongst the unprotected workers, so on and so forth. But that will not be if there is equality in education, if there is equality in other social services, so on and so forth. So this is our agenda. Aam Aadmi Party has partly in their Delhi manifesto brought out all this. Otherwise, we did question them and we will question them. Aam Aadmi Party has not tried to join hands with BJP nor with Congress. We are fighting every political party in all states, because we as NAPM, as People's Movements, are in 20 states. We are fighting the NJD government in Orissa and the communists when they were there in West Bengal to Kerala, where there are best of the social parameters, let me tell you. In spite of 134th rank on the Human Development Index of India, which we should not be proud of, the Kerala has the best parameters. So certainly the left front had achieved the land reforms in partial way. I will elaborate if you ask me, and other things. But still there were the same kind of paradigm, same kind of land transfer, etc. So we questioned them also. Aam Aadmi Party also have to question all the parties in the coming days. And when Congress supported them, do you think it would have done so if they were to join hands with BJP? Sometimes they are blamed of supporting BJP, sometimes they are blamed of supporting Congress. But we know that amongst ideologues, there are also people like Yogendra Yadav, Prashant Bhushan, Ajit Zahu, have straight away gone from National Alliance of People's Movements to the Aam Aadmi Party. And not as a design, not as a conspiracy, that is what also is being blamed of, but not at all. We remained with the movements and we still will remain, but we have ensured that they are not communal. If they make mistakes in terms of their approach to gender justice, they make wrong statements, we counter those and we will have. I am not a member of the Aam Aadmi Party as yet, but we support them, their political intervention, and we will also go in for intervention maybe. This is the kind of reality which is very complex, and it's a party in the making, as they themselves have to accept. It is also their ideology is also in the making. That's why many of the movement people feel, oh, how can we join or how can we support unless there is a clarity on all these issues, unless there is depth in all these issues? How can we support a young lady who takes up the charge of the women and child welfare and makes some statement which we cannot accept? How can we support a law minister who makes some mistakes and we cannot support? We are supporting their way of campaigning, their way of getting on to an alternative agenda, their way of involving not just voters and electorates, but also the people in the movements, which is yet not very perfect. But still, I think that also is something in the present political crisis and economic crisis and social crisis. I stop here. I wanted to fill the gap, so again I am taking longer time and longer answers.
Thank you, Madam. The next question on the other side.
But Congress also cannot be supported so easily only because it is secular, let me tell you. The communal and secular is not the only divide today. The corrupt and the non-corrupt, the grabbers and the non-grabbers are also the designs. And within BJP there are people who are joining Aam Party. And within Congress, there are people who are now joining Aam Aadmi Party. Those who are afraid that their party will not take them to the agenda they themselves would like to see coming through. And what does that mean? A mixture. So many people are afraid of that also. But I tell my colleagues that, see, in movements also this happens. When we mobilize farmers, all are not clear about what should be there in the labor sector with their own workers in the field. They don't know how to deal with them. But then they change. When they listen to the Adivasis whom they used to call Bhilda in the real story of the Narmada Valley. The farmers in the plains would call Adivasis as Bhildas, not Bhils, because they were their agricultural laborers. When the same Bhils started giving articulated speeches, and they do even today, better than the big farmers, they have to bow before them. So this kind of change keeps coming. The women who were not at the forefront ever, the Jat women, let me refer to the caste societies within, which is also a reality, we cannot forget it, although we are for caste annihilation as the ultimate point of our logical victory. But women were never there from those caste communities which were not in Khaf panchayats, maybe not that bad, but at least they were not in the movements. They were not even raising one question in the Gram Sabhas. But when they came out in the movement, that was the real experience of small micro replica of larger women's liberation. You need not even go on giving speeches to them. They started acting, they started entering the World Bank offices and questioning them. Do you have children, was their question. They didn't say, as IFI, what are you doing to our country? But that simple motherly question was enough to make the World Bank officials say that, my mother, I will not permit the government that is seeking money to encroach upon your farms. Enough. I think the women also changed, and the men changed in their attitudes, partly, not fully. It's not so easy.
Thank you, Vedali. We have about 8 more questions at least lined up, and we have a lot of them quite soon, so I'll go to the next question.
I will be brief. I know what you suggest.
So I see a lot of Marathi cases, that's why.
Very good.
Marathi introduction. So I'm from Ambulu, and my family is a displaced family for one of the dams in Maharashtra, that is Port Story.
Which one?
That is Dhom Grand.
Hmm?
Dhom.
Dhom. Okay. So Kaner and Dhom.
Yeah,
Koyna Valley.
Yeah. Now, I'm a great supporter of you. And I sent a lot of lectures. I actually attended some of the lectures in person, and I am not asking this question in first time. So you may forget that, but I'm just reminding that. Now, I work with Narendra Dabhulkar and Sakshar Kamuni and things like that. Just this background is very important. But I got hurt.
Hurt.
When Supreme Court of India, and I believe you believe in our Supreme Court of India came, and I read that 70-page document, and it says that basically Narmada Bachao Andolan, which is NBA, is misled the Supreme Court, all the 3 Supreme Justices, and they said that this cannot be accepted. I got hurt. Why the Supreme Court of India, you could not just prove them that whatever claims you are making are right. That is one thing I think I can solve that. Second thing that happened is basically there are reports. There are reports coming from the, I forgot her name, Urmila Ken, or a letter to the foreign minister. She is saying that you have ties to the foreign people. And when Supreme Court justice came, within 20 minutes you are sending the email to somebody, and that guy is asking how you manage Supreme Court. I mean, that puts a great question on your credibility. And now you just gave us such a good lecture, influential lecture, where I'm thinking, wow, this is for humanity and we really need to help the people. But that puts big question on your credibility, because now what you are telling today, tomorrow you may not stand in Supreme Court, and we will know that whatever you are saying was not right and it cannot be supported anymore. And I don't want to actually comment on political thing here, because this is not political forum. But we are in Southern California, and this is basically a desert. Now, this is the biggest drought in Southern California. Now, where from this water is coming? Where this process is working? Where we are getting the drinking water from the fountain. Of course, there is displacement. There is a lot of displacement, there is a lot of pain, and that needs to be addressed. But We just cannot say that the dam like poor dam nearby cannot be built, because that is not necessary and we have to do it. It is same thing as when Arjuna got the Khandaprastha. Krishna said, what do you want to do with this? Do you want to build Indraprastha? Then you want to burn this. You want, people are going to kill, animals will be killed. But then are you going to build better thing or not? And that is the question I would like to ask, and I want your clear answer on the credibility issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to clear. I was telling in the informal discussions yesterday, there is a lot of fake criticism going on. I will start from your first allegation, which you are referring to others' allegation, but I suppose that is in your mind as well. And so I must answer it. Will you please sit? I would take little time. This is very important. And if it has hurt you, it has hurt us also. But we are very much confident of our conscience, and so we survive. You see this, the Narmada Bachao Andolan is misleading the Supreme Court. You know in what context it was said? In one of the dams, Omkareshwar, where I am not personally involved, because in Narmada Andolan now we have decentralized the movement and different colleagues are taking care of different dams, because it is huge work, 1300 kilometers long stretch. So there other colleagues of mine are working, and so the case was filed, and the case was being pleaded by none else but Advocate Rajiv Dhawan and Sanjay Parikh, and who do not even charge us for the cases that they take. Now we plead our own cases also, along with sometimes them standing by. So this case, the issue was so simple, I tell you. You won't believe that Supreme Court can pass such judgments. Now I don't want to pass judgments on the Supreme Court. Again, you will question the credibility and our faith in judiciary. But because we have faith in judiciary, we have so many cases before the judges, and we are pleading those, and we are getting umpteen number of good judgments, let me tell you that. This is the only and the first time that judgment, that order was passed. And in what context? There are five villages where the land is acquired, but the land is still in possession of the people, the farmers. But the land is transferred on paper in the government's name. So who is in possession of the land is the question. De jure, the possession lies with the government, and de facto, the possession lies with the farmers. So throughout the case, all affidavits clarified this position. Only in the last affidavit, one word was used by our advocate on the insistence of one of my activist colleague that no, you should say to the court that actual possession is with the government, because the ownership of land is transferred to the government. So you make that clear, because the government was arguing that, oh, they are still cultivating, what is wrong? And our position was, my colleagues, that the flooding will come and all the five villages will go underwater, and they are now excluding them from the submergence area, as they have done in the case of Sardar Sarovar. 55 villages they have excluded, while they are densely populated villages and backwater levels cannot change. So the center is not accepting that change, but the government is going ahead with the change, saying you are now out of submergence. After having acquired land, without even giving back the ownership to the people, they are saying now you are not submergence. So we are fighting that battle also. So in the whole of Narmada Valley, this is the situation. They acquire land, and Acquisition Act, which was used till December. Now we got that changed after so much struggle, after so many inputs. The new act has come from 1st January 2014. But let me tell you, in the last week of December, so many land acquisition awards were passed. Till 31st December midnight, the governments passed the awards only to not have the new act applicable in that situation. There's such vulgar designs. So coming back to the case, this was the matter of debate. And the government of Madhya Pradesh is very vicious on the Narmada issue against us. Huge corruption we have dug out in rehabilitation. Commission of inquiry is appointed. 3,000 fake cell deeds were typed and false photographs, false signatures to show that people have got land. But fortunately, the High Court, we won, and the Commission of Inquiry is sitting, and through inquiry, the rehabilitation that they were claiming is exposed, and that's why Sardar Sarovar Dam is stopped. Even today, at the height of 122 meters and 17 meters, gates are not permitted to be put up. So Narendra Modi is very upset. But it is the court's judgments and law and everything. If that is to be followed, 2.5 lakh people cannot be submerged. Where also the similar situation is like the five villages. And you won't believe that they filed an application to charge us of perjury. And we were shocked. For the first time, so many times government gives such false data, false claims. We expose the judgment of 2005 has covered how they changed by thousands the number of families in the case of Sardar Sarovar. We never filed an application of perjury. That was our mistake. If we file the contempt petition, the court says, oh, why contempt? You change it to some application. Maybe they have gone wrong. Never does court easily takes up the contempt cases in the Indian courts, let me tell you, which is very unfortunate. So they go ahead with the false data. And on this issue, they file that application. And immediately, you know, the district judge was appointed. He went. He again gave, as we gave, all the situation as it is. And court passed an order, as if they were all ready to pass that order. Let me say so. And then the review application was filed. Some of the remarks were expunged by the same court after hearing our lawyers, who were very strongly against. Rajendra Sachar Saab and so many senior lawyers were sitting in the court when the review application was heard. They expunged some of the remarks. They kept some of the remarks. So that review judgment also is not used by those who are campaigning against us using that judgment. And let me tell you who is campaigning against us. Whether it is the allegation of foreign funding, they could never prove it. The Supreme Court, they lost it, lost the case, and they had to pay the cost. That petition of theirs was treated as a public-private interest litigation. Who are they? There is one person who is the CEO of Adani Company in Gujarat. And he has been continuously working with the Urmila Ben Patel, sending that fake emails, fake correspondence. I finally had to take help of our colleagues who are experts in IT. They found out the emails had come from Ahmedabad. Now my defamation case, not on the emails issue, because no one published that except Pioneer, and you know who Pioneer belonged to. But otherwise, no one published that correspondence. It was a fake thing to catch hold of Prashant Bhushan, as who was our lawyer in Narmada case with Shanti Bhushan ji. And it was all a fake game. Anyway, that is the emails issue. The foreign funding issue, we have not taken foreign funds. And yet, this fellow gave an advertisement. He came with a check when we were all in jail for 14 days and made a fake check. That check comes from the branch of one bank where all Ambani's accounts lie. And that account does not exist, was the answer given by the local bank. They gave the check to an Ayurvedic doctor who was our supporter and with whom we were running the Jeevan Shalas, the schools of life. And because we were not registered organization then, now we have a registered org. So we were saying that you put the accounts so that audit will be done, you know. And all of this, he had complained to Narendra Modi. Narendra Modi had written to Advani. Advani's ministry had written back to Narendra Modi. All of this correspondence came to the court through the central ministry because he also made them a party. And that correspondence showed that they carried out twice all investigation of all our records and accounts, and nothing illegal was found. That was the answer given by Home Ministry of India when Advani was the Home Minister to Mr. Narendra Modi. So this is the thing, and I know that they are again, they will be playing if we enter the electoral politics, much more so. Our defamation cases are going on. Court is asking us to compromise, but he was also the person who was involved in attacking me physically, as it happened in Sabarmati Ashram in the post-riot peace meeting when I went on, when I was invited. And that criminal case is also against him and some of the Congress and BJP stalwarts who were jointly had attacked. There were 40 witnesses, all topmost Gandhians and all missionaries and activists were there. So fortunately, that case has now started after 10 full years in the Ahmedabad Magistrate Court. So let me tell you, there are these kinds of elements. Now it will be much more so. So Ambanis and Adanis cannot favor us. They only can do this kind of thing. They were false advertisements, this and that. And you will get these emails. Now one French journalist also is writing. I am told he belongs to Vishwa Hindu Parishad and Sri Sri Ravi Shankar's disciple he is. But I don't know. I have never replied to his articles, which are based on the same propaganda. So there will be now many more who will take up the propaganda. But, you know, I can always sue them in court, but spending time in court every time is also useless. That is what their game is. So we don't want to do that. But these are the elements which are always alleged. They will allege Aam Aadmi Party on many things which are fake. If there is truth in that, we will be able to face it. But if there is no truth in this kind of propaganda, how can we face it? And why should we waste our time in that? But I wasted some time of yours because you may read that tomorrow. I say, oh, yesterday she gave us such a speech. But then, you know, the credibility is to be questioned, as he tells me. About the dams, we are not saying there should be no external source of water, but begin with an internal source as far as the smallest unit is concerned and then go to the larger units. Otherwise, the large dams do provide water to cities, and bigger the city, larger the water share, and I can give you that statistics, but it diverts it away from irrigation and drinking water to the needy population, which is always in the original plan. And it also gives to industries at the cost of the agriculture, which is also an unregistered industrious and industrial occupation, as we believe it to be, since there is also input, throughput, output, that is production. So I'm not saying that no dam is benefiting no one, but equity and justice doesn't come through. There is World Commission on Dams report. I was one of the commissioners. We did an exercise on large dams across the world. The World Bank, to the companies that built the dams and the displaced people and the government representatives, all presented their cases, and 1,000 consultants were appointed, and they did the number of surveys. And you can read that report that is on the website somewhere, www.dams.org. That is an unanimous report, which is our position on large dams. There is only one dissent note of mine, because they did not challenge water privatization, which we do challenge.
Thank you. Thank you for all the details around this.
I actually come from a small village in Karnataka, so I am familiar with the land being utilized for building dams and all. So what you did for the people getting the right amount of compensation is a good thing. But we talked about the people in Maharashtra committing suicide and all, right? So why are they committing suicide? Because in India, it's like Allah Ta'ala ki meherbani hai. If there is no rain, there is no agriculture, so people are dying there for no money. So I think your opposition for building dams, the reason they are committing suicide is because they don't have enough water to irrigate their lands. I think so there has to be, the reason all of us are here is because somebody named Hoover built a dam somewhere down south, and water comes from there. This is the desert. All of Southern California is basically an arid desert. I don't know if you know this, but we are sitting on a desert right now. But only because of water coming from a dam, we are at least drinking water and drinking chai all the time. So, I understand and I fully agree with your desire to help the people, but I just want to hear from you on the balancing aspect. Second thing regarding Aam Aadmi Party. You see, anti-corruption thing is a good thing. He came with a list of corrupt politicians, CDM, Sonia Gandhi, Rajiv Gandhi, everybody, That's a good thing. But, you said criminal and secular he met with some cleric called, Sunni cleric called Maulana Takir Lana or something in Bareilly. Okay. So this guy openly called for beheading of Taslima Nasreen, who is a Bangladeshi author, human rights activist. The same Maulana Takir Lana, whom Kejriwal went and asked for votes from his community, also praised Osama bin Laden. So how can you be secular by quoting, you know, terrorist sympathizers on one hand and other hand? So you have to be equal. You cannot always go back 10 years back, 20 years back, or go back to 1947 when Jinnah and Gandhi sat together to divide India. So, you know, there has to be equality. You know, you cannot be just, you know, it cannot be one-sided. That's my question. Thank you.
I
want to
hear from you.
About dams or position I have just put forth. But you are right that at least rehabilitation has to be an issue. And that's not a small issue. The dams or any development projects, according to us, cannot be judged or sanctioned only on the economic and financial criteria. You have the economic rate of return or the financial rate of return, as the World Bank does, or you have 1:1.5 as the benefit cost ratio, as the Planning Commission of India put forth as a condition for clearing the project. You have to have the social and environmental criteria as well. And on those criteria, as the World Commission on Dams also concluded, although the commissioners included the World Bank's advisor, the South African Water Resource Minister, the Planning Commission member, I was the representative of Moments and so on. And we had such a good, what is called as a global policy making exercise for 2.5 years when we toured across the world, we heard the people, but we also studied and got studied the details of Three Gorges Dam in China, to the Tarbela in Pakistan, the dams in Amazon, to the dams in India. And we found that the governments do not look back and do not review or recalculate their economic parameters and the criteria to see whether those are really complied with or not. And there these dams invariably fail. There are to be equity criteria, there are to be rehabilitation criteria, there are to be ecological sustainability criteria. Otherwise, as in one of the cartoons, R.K. Lakshman, you know, the famous cartoonist who is bedridden today. But he had drawn that cartoon saying when the nervous agitation was also at its peak, I suppose, to show that the common man, not the present Ahmad Bhi, the common man, was asking an engineer standing on the top of the dam as to, okay, so now tell me about this dam. Is there anything wrong in this dam? So the engineer says, no, there is nothing wrong. The dam is perfect. The only thing that went wrong is that the river is lost. The dam is standing. So this is the situation in India today. And it can be in many, many parts of the world. And it is. So the large dams, to start with, without managing and tapping the resources in the catchment, without treating the catchment, is not the scientifically correct way if you think of even 23rd century, leave aside behind. And even today, that technology, which is followed without the proper preconditional compensatory measures, is bringing in not only the loss to the affected people, but also the loss to the so-called beneficiaries. That's what I was pointing out. I'm pleading a case, and I showed the judgment yesterday, the Chief Justice of Madhya Pradesh, on the canals issue. The canals which are brought from the upstream dams into the lower dam of Sardar Sarovar area, that those are destroying the best of agricultural land, which is not even acquired on both sides, up to 3 kilometers. Now the Chief Justice has ordered compliance on all conditions from 1987 clearance letter to the expert committee's review in 2013. And now they have to present before 14th and 17th, I have to plead the case again. After extensive hearings, he got convinced that at least those conditions should be fulfilled. He said, don't stop the canal. He said, no, we will not stop if the conditions are fulfilled. Same is the case on rehabilitation. 11,000 families in Sardar Sarovar have got land for land. That is the only dam in the world having struggled for 29 years, 30th year has just begun of our struggle. So it is only in that dam, not in any other dam in Narmada Valley, not in any other dam elsewhere. In Maharashtra, you know, the Dhom you referred to, 25% of Dhom's displaced population is not reachable today. That is the post-dam review of the Tata Institute of Social Sciences assigned by the government of Maharashtra. So it is very, very clear that if you review the situation, the benefits also do not come true. So what we are saying is, you first treat the catchment, build the catchment, you first have the command area development planning so that there is drainage facility available. It is not that water is only beneficial. Flood is not beneficial. Similarly, flood is beneficial if the flood recedes and the flood plains are left with the beautiful silt. That is a different story. That is why we are not for, embanking the rivers. That is a foolish idea. Let me tell you, if there are Biharis, I can explain that. So, you know, there is illiteracy on the environmental aspects, and there is unconcern and insensitivity on the rehabilitation aspects. And from that point of view also, these projects are questionable till at least the conditions are fulfilled. That is our position. Having said that, you said that something done by Arvind Kejriwal. I don't know which Maulana he has met, except if that is the case, we are with Taslima. The NAPM has issued statements when she was in Calcutta, and I was also involved in the Nandigram movement. We also issued statement from there as NAPM West Bengal with myself. So we will not support that move of Arvind Kejriwal if he has gone wrong. But then every party has every single wrong move and right move and so on. And we still hold dialogue with them. We don't reject anyone. They reject us sometimes, but we don't. We don't even boycott media. I told Times Now also that, look, I will keep coming. You target me and I get the best chance to answer your counters. But we won't, because media will sometimes support us, sometimes not support us. After all, what matters is your conscience and your commitment. And I think that will go a long way. So even Aam Aadmi Party, when the movements are supporting, we are keeping our movements intact. We are keeping the National Alliance of People's Movements intact. That's why I'm still not a member of the Aam Aadmi Party, because 2.5 state units of National Alliance have said don't enter electoral politics, while others have said no, you may enter, and we should support Aam Aadmi Party also. So we are supporting them, but we are also already planned a meeting in July of the movements, when we had one meeting in Sevagram before elections last month. We have also planned a July meeting, because we know that we will be surviving even then, whatever may happen in between. So you also should be critical of them. Everyone has a right to be critical of every politician, every party, and every movement also. We also may be going wrong sometimes. Sometimes our own closest colleagues commit something that we have to take the responsibility, say sorry. So I think that simple and straightforwardness is better. So you question to Arvind Kejriwal, and he is that kind of straight answering person. At least that much you should grant him.
Thank you, Mirali, for the clarification. Next question will come from the lady on the left.
Please.
Hi. So I don't need to speak on behalf of anyone, but I think that many of us are beneficiaries of globalization and privilege. So coming from this power and the privilege that we have living in America, what can we do to stand in solidarity with those people that are struggling, and how can we raise awareness or use our privilege to just basically be in solidarity and progress?
Let me just repeat the last sentence.
So how can we use our privilege to contribute to the movement?
Okay. Hello. Are you there? You know the part of the game, if I can call it so. Some people even call it business, but part of the game that is a political game, that is the movement politics, which we define as setting the relationship between the state and its people, right? Or it can also be differently defined as setting the relationships between the various sections of population, right? Beyond caste, creed, other kinds of gender and discriminations, and also beyond that kind of hierarchy between our own representatives voted for and elected by us and we the powerless. Please sit. I feel uncomfortable. Then I can take longer time. Many times actually they are powerless, let me tell you. And that's why we were and we are still today in much dilemma as to whether to really become member of parliament or remain outside as powerful movement participants. That is because many times the members of parliament say, look, what can we do? We raise the issue and they give a false answer. And then hakka bhanga, the privileges of theirs and breach of privilege. That motion can be brought only in the next parliamentary session, which is after months. Meanwhile, destruction, displacement, injustice, whatever happens. So please, you help us. You raise the question from my parliamentary constituency or my assembly constituency so that I will get a chance to go and seek an appointment with the chief minister. This is also a reality. And then we say, oh, so you are so powerless. I will not give you that example, but the case of Sri Lankan Tamils issue, for which I was recently for one day in London and gave an address to the conference. I feel that the Foreign Affairs Minister and all of them with whom I was in dialogue even when the Jan Lokpal movement was on the issue of Nazareth fast and otherwise, all these ministers, you see, really behave in such a way in all these situations, whether it was Ramlila Maidan movement or the Sri Lankan Tamilian issue, that we have to tell them that, look, you seem to be very powerless, I think we and our people are more powerful. Let us go ahead with our own politics. So this is the scenario. Where was I? Sorry, I missed the time. What question was it? No, so I was saying that in that political game, these different players, happen to be presenting themselves as powerful that they are and powerless that we are. But in fact, in many situations, we experience that we are more powerful than their powerlessness that they express inadvertently sometimes. So I'm saying that in this situation, who stand by us matters a lot. You see, just me as a catalytic activist standing by the Adivasis in the forest of Satpura or Vindhya, where even the land rights in generations were not granted, brought the land rights. It was not just my standing behind. As an advocate, you play a role, but people struggle there. So same is in the courts and same is outside. So we have this complementarity of field level struggles and the legal battles both. And that's why we win most of the battles. Otherwise, we would have lost as we did in that small little case, which is used against us everywhere without even quoting the reviewed order. Let me tell you again. So it is in that situation where you can stand by us. And today in the global economics and politics, you are standing by us, not literally standing, but come to India and stand by us sometimes. But otherwise, be with us. Being with us really matters. Because, you know, just as an Adivasi would go and they will not even offer a seat unless I would say that, look, hum char log hai, agar char kursiyan hai, to hum baithenge nahi, to hum niche baithenge, aap kursi par baithe ho, koi dikkat nahi. So similarly, if you take a position and convey that to the government, if you are Indian citizens or you are NRI also, they are resident non-Indians. So you please communicate your support and solidarity to us as NRIs. Those RNIs will really behave much better way. That is what is experienced by us many times. So these kinds of campaigns, these kinds of pressurization, if you can call it, but pressurization sometimes, you pressurize judges. No, I had not even seen the face of that judge which they are referring to, because he paid the cost, he is very upset and he is circulating that kind. So it is always, these kinds of elements who are to be countered only when your type of people write, they get their due. And you can also support by coming as interns. That goes a long way, let me tell you. Because, you see, after all, you need a thorn to remove a thorn. In that way, this whole global world and this thing, that's why I said I don't myself work on the computers, but I use the technology through my colleagues who can even do the research and give us the information. This Ultra Tech Cement company, I asked my colleagues immediately, you do the search and find out what that company is. I found that they are joined the JP Associates, whose record of human rights violations, firing for the cement plants in Madhya Pradesh is absolutely known to everyone. And the Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh and his wife are also accused of corruption in the JP's company and the enterprise. So we became very clear that who they are and how they should be, investigated on. So this kind of research also can come through. There are number of, media. When we have an idiom, we have a vision, we have something, we means all those urban and rural people. And you have to promote that. That promotion is not to be left to the mainstream media. So what would be the alternative media? Our own small magazines, tumhi te aanle ka andolan, nikal sangitlo ta khara janna sangala tumhala. Because we have a small magazine, all the Marathi speakers, Marathi listeners should hopefully will become members and subscribers of our magazine. I've left some with Vishakha ji also. And that brings our message. But such a low cost and low key exercises ours are, you won't believe. You may think that we have challenged the builders and we have taken the attacks and whatever, all my colleagues also, but we are still a very, very low key operators. And this high speed and high technology and hi-fi is much distant to us. At least Narmada Bachao Andolan, I can tell you. Still, some of my colleagues are using it effectively. Some students from this end who then came to Bangalore started the website. We have ourselves not even started a website. Recently, because that website was not fed and nothing was appearing well, there are mass programs every month in the Narmada Valley. Some of our colleagues prepared a blog. I have not even seen the face of the blog, believe me. I would like to, now I have to sit and do that exercise. But you people can certainly help us in this, because we have no time, no energy, no capacities. But the interns, when they come, they take up certain assignments, whether of Jivanchalas or of struggle, and that goes a long way. Similarly, the Aid India volunteers helped us a lot. Asha volunteers sometimes helped us a lot. So I think these groups of the Indian students and even beyond, many foreign students also come, they are alleged. and we have to defend them and so on. And we are alleged that while we feed them, we are told that, oh, they come means funds must be coming. No, not. We have not taken even the foreign money of the foreign awards for Narmada Bachchan Andolan. With a condition that no money should come to Narmada, the money is kept with the trust or one American organization, which is almost finished money now. So there are umpteen number of such examples. You can do that. You can also use the IT from here and start campaigns and also raise debates, circulate our interviews. YouTube has many of our films, but there is also one very false fact-based film on Narmada on YouTube, which I came to know much later. I gave a good interview orally, because I belong to that tradition more, on the Sardar Patel statue related speech of Narendra Modi and his speeches, where he says that we are giving free electricity to Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh. Absolutely false. 29,000 hectares of land is going from these two states, and they are not to have one right to one drop of water in Sardar Sarovar. Only electricity for which they are contributing capital cost, but that is Narendra Modi. I have made that statement that it is a campaign of falsehood from him, because on many issues the face that he is presenting is like a filmy hero and nothing less than that. And Rahul Gandhi also is making a mess of many issues. He doesn't know many issues, and when he gives an interview, the voters turn to Modi maybe, and so on and so forth. But there is no real truth, even facts on this. So help us counter this kind of propaganda. The press notes and all keeps coming from us. We can include you all on the list, and that list is served by all my colleagues regularly. That is happening. I write by hand, they type and send it. There are other ways. Arpana Sindhur is here. She did a beautiful dance theater she belongs to. Just asked her that word. And she performed on Narmada. And what a beautiful performance. You should have it here sometime. And she has now taken the other issues also. And she, it's just like it is one woman play, it is, let us call it. And she shows how the dam and the affected people, and through her dance and song along, no? Song also is there? Yeah. She made a number of performances she gave, and everyone who watched those got changed. So you can also have the dramas to films. The poster, the flyer here, I found out, I've still not seen that lady, whosoever designed it. I said, okay, huh?
She's
that? That's what I thought that, but she did not introduce us that while we were coming. So yesterday her husband is with the camera. So I said that she can draw such posters for us. We have advocates free of cost in Narmada, I'm telling you. No one we have paid, not Shanti Bhushan, not Sanjay Parikh. We just pay little bit when there is so much of photocopying of thousands of rupees. But there is no condition of that sort we have accepted for public interest litigation. There's a principle. I went and told every lawyer that you take private cases. This much you have. Our office is built with free land, free bricks from the Kumars, the potters who are also fighting with us, free wood and old wood by every Adivasi family in our hilly areas, free sand by the plains villages with Gram Panchayats giving it, free bore well, and not one paisa coming from that region when our one storied Karyalay office was built when we completed 25 full years, 3 years back. So this kind of efforts can come, in-kind help can come from different persons, and we take also financial support, but only in Indian currency, because we don't have foreign contribution FCRA Act. But it is certain that other women's also require funds. The networking also requires funds. Some activists I know whom they are giving fellowship are doing wonderful job. We cannot have disparity in our organization, so we have a different this thing. But We still require a lot of funds for running the schools. We take Indian donations, we take in-kind support. All furniture in our office have come from closed down offices. Nothing we purchase almost. It comes from the kitchens when we need utensils, so on and so forth. So you can also do that in Maharashtra, in India. Some district people send truckload of old furniture, old things which we are using for Jeevan Chala recently. So you can also do that. You cannot send a truckload to India, but encourage your colleagues, your account holders in India to support. And if you give us 1 month or 1 year, nothing like that. And from here, whatever you can do, of course, is most welcome. And those who join IFA also will be doing a good job. It may not come to Narmada Bacho Andolan, but for other fellows, there are also some NAPM activists who are fellows of IFA, let me tell you that. And they are also doing the great work. It's not based on the money that is coming. Now, some people all cannot survive without money. It means huge difference. So even that is helpful. But currency disparity itself must go away, do away with. And that I did not discuss. But this internationalism against the present globalization, we hope will somehow lead us to that end where there is no difference in the currency values. That is also our dream.
So we are out of time, we'll intervene, I'm sorry. So there have been three gentlemen waiting, so what I'll do is I'll just have them ask the question and you can give a brief 1 or 2 minute answer and then you can talk more. They also want
yeah.
to talk to you more.
Let us take all questions together.
Yeah, we'll just take these three questions actually right now. And within 2 minutes after that, our president would like to thank you, so we'll go to that like in 2 minutes. So let's quick.
That you can skip, so I get extra 2 minutes.
No.
And thank you for coming today. Thank you for Back to Fighting. And the Back to Fighting resonates with many other battles fought across the world. There's Back to the Colorado River again. There's the Amazonas. There's the Aborigines in Australia. There's the Congo Basin. Say that we fought everywhere. So how about a united front that everybody fights for each other instead of this limited small battles everywhere?
Yeah, so I'll move on to the next question.
Thank you, ma'am. So you did mention about the reservation system in a lot of the answers. My question is that all cosmic players play more than vote and politics. With respect to this, I want to know your opinion and views on the reservation system and how, instead of caste-based reservation, you can have economic-based reservation and how introduction of the exit clause or a plea in the reservation system can be helpful. Thank you.
My name is Sidhu. I just have a simple question. Do you want to contest next question? And we'll have to stop right here. And Mani Srikant, you had a long talk today morning also. So today.
I didn't recognize him.
Sure. So what we will do.
Please, let him ask questions.
Yes, absolutely.
You cut my time, not theirs.
We are going to stop this in 2 minutes. You'll have to talk to it after.
Exactly.
No. I am in your terminology, Hindu permanent person. And I say, Isha Vasanidam Sarvam Yatim Chajigatyam Chai, which teaches what you have is not yours, you have lived, only take what, how much you want to take. Rest is given to the society. Whenever you, I believe, in the last 60 years, due to secularism, like somebody pointed out, you don't allow teaching this sentence in the schools because you are against Hindutva. So if you don't teach this value, where how will you end consumerism? Okay, so that is all we have at the moment. And just try to give a brief answer in 2 minutes. We have to vacate the hall. So, and for longer conversation, satisfied. You want more details, please talk to me. She'll be here for some time. Thank you very much.
I start with yours. Why don't you come and sit? No, please. Not knowing your question that he was stopping, because you, I think, came in later. So that's why he stopped you. We will like to be fair. And we are not saying that we don't learn from Hindu religion. People will call me also Hindu and not Muslim. But I don't, follow strict rituals. While I also pray God and I also go to the mosques in the and the gurudwaras and churches if I'm permitted to. And we respect everyone's cultures and conditions and so on. And for that matter, what has come from the Hindu tradition, which is the best part of it, of whether simplicity or Swadeshi kind of thing, to that extent that it is reflected into that philosophy, we salute it and we take it and we say that everyone should have it. But there is a number of things which are in the Islam as well, and that also we respect equally. That is the difference between a fundamentalist and a secular person. Nothing else. And we have in Narmada, I was just telling Mr. Sharma in the morning, Prarthana. In politics, I said it.
No, you said it.
I said dharma nirapekshata in politics and sarva dharma samabhav in society. Dharma nirapekshata in politics means that if Mr. Digvijay Singh goes and only visits temples and Hindu saints and doesn't participate, he did, but I'm saying as an example, doesn't participate going to a mosque or in the, any Eidga program also, then that will not be dharma nirapekshata. That is in politics. I have gone through extensive debates and discussions on this and then taking this position. And so I feel that at least that level of secularism must be there if anyone has to rule the country. And that is not reflected in many of the politicians. Others, even in their own parties, do not promote what they say and what they follow. So there are secular people in all parties and there are non-secular communal people in even so-called secular parties. There are casteist people in the parties that promote and support reservations or that promote and support the cause of the scheduled caste. You have to judge not just the parties but also individuals. And there I feel that the best of every religion to be taken in is our approach. I have read the Dharmapal's literature and we know that India, with even that religion which is of the majority today, had much to give to the world and more to the present world when it comes to architecture, to agriculture. And that, if it is in Vedas, we respect the Vedas and take that from that, but we cannot follow Manusmriti, otherwise the gender justice would never be coming true. So this is our position. I think we also know the Muslim fundamentalists. The Jamaat-e-Islami, when they took a very, very discriminatory stand, and whenever they took it, we questioned it. When they called me for the human rights related conference, I went to the dais, but first sentence I made was that I do not approve your fundamentalist politics or your way of thinking, and still I am here because I believe that human rights, just a minute then, what's it, you are not comfortable.
I did.
The Swadeshi Jagran Manch is related to RSS. You know that very well. And Bharatiya Kisan Sangh is also related to RSS. They attended our meetings in Narmadala. We went. When they took a different position, some of the farmers and the office bearers of Bharatiya Kisan Sangh also filed an intervening petition, but it was void of all data, so that was rejected. Otherwise, Bharatiya Kisan Sangh, we would have supported, and they were supporting us as a farmers organization, knowing very well they are affiliates of BJP. Similarly, the CPI's ITAC, we still support ITAC. I still participate in the bank officers union. I could not cover everything in one speech. And I am facing cases in the lowest court of Delhi even today because I participated in and, breached the, violated the 144. But we opposed them when it came to Nandigram. So whether on the communal secular divide or on the divide on the basis of development paradigm, we have our viewpoints and we are at least hopefully not fundamentalists. If we go anywhere wrong, you can counter us. But I will only tell you, friends, for this, the experience of Ayodhya. And that is very important. And because, no, why? Ek minute me. In Ayodhya,
there will not be any back and forth interaction. Hold on, excuse me, sir.
Ek minute. Nitin bhai. Let me.
That's fine. That's all. That is fine.
No,
right now, we have to make it.
Is now seen as an eco-terrorist. Because what is happening is basically you are coming from the so left. Okay, you are just becoming a
so left. I'm not a Maoist.
No, what I'm saying is
sir,
the ecological
sir, thank you.
I think that was the only thing you have forgotten to mention in your earlier speech, because that is another allegation which you have forgotten to mention. No, in Ayodhya, I will just tell you, the fact of Ayodhya is, my friends, so then you can you just test what you feel at the bottom of your heart. The fact of Ayodhya is, then that is the tradition of Hinduism and Islam both. The fact in Ayodhya is that there are hundreds of temples in Ayodhya. I really shiver that the land was given by Nababs for building many of the temples in Ayodhya. The Muslim population that grow the Jhenduka phool are used in the garlanding even today. And the Ram Naam ke Gamche used are also coming from the Muslim handloom weavers. That is the tradition. And I went to the temples in Ayodhya, the Lal Gadi and all, and the Maharaj said that Ayodhya was always a secular place. Secular you define in your own way. And Iran ki Rani ne isiliye ye kaha tha, ye main Hindi mein hi bol sakti hu, ki mera dafan Ayodhya mein hona chahiye, kyunki wahan interreligious harmony exists. To ye tha. हम लोग सब लोग जो इंडिया को मानते हैं और इंडिया से आते हैं या जो पाकिस्तान को मानते हैं और पाकिस्तान से आते हैं, जिन्ना के बारे में तो मैं नहीं बोल सकती, अडवाणी जी ने ही बहुत कुछ कहा है, उसे कुछ कहने की जरूरत नहीं है. एंड समवेयर समटाइम्स यू फील एट द बॉटम ऑफ हार्ट एंड यू से इट, वेदर इट इज अडवाणी और मी और यू. एंड सो आई थिंक यू गो टू दिस बेस्ट ऑफ द ट्रेडिशंस नॉट ओनली इन इंडिया across the world and support the humanitarian religion. That is a way of life. That is what we want. So that not only the riots but also wars will come to an end. Terrorism will come to an end. Whether the Asimananda is giving a true statement or not, that will be investigated. Let it be investigated. But that should be investigated.
Till that time we will say that lions
No. In Malegaon and in every riot scenario, I interacted with both. And I think that intervention was useful to bring in peace. And that is the agenda ultimately for all of us. Thank you. We will talk following this.
I have the tradition of an honorarium for our distinguished speakers, but Vedaji is unable to accept that, and we will look into how we will look into the other ways that I pick and help.
Not illegal ways, don't worry, otherwise they will again say so.
Please be sure to register at the front desk, and you can
you will be on the mailing list. You can see that. You will receive a message about how you can help Milady's work and how you can join IFA as well as the IFA Young Professionals Group. Now, in closing, I would like to have a round of applause for the IFA Young Professionals Group.
And thanks to all of you.
Tea and snacks are served outside, and we have someone with a bouquet for you.
And thanks to all of you for listening so patiently, and irrespective of differences, I hope the dialogue will continue. And it was a real pleasure and privilege.